Good morning. Welcome to Charlotte Congregational Church. Whoever you are and wherever you are on your spiritual journey or your physical journey, you are welcome here this morning. Special welcome to people worshiping with us online this morning. I have a couple of announcements. We're so excited to have Stephen Kiernan here for the sermon this morning. Thank you, Stephen, for being here. Thank you for masking. And also, thank you for not singing during the hymn time. Just another opportunity to love our neighbors as ourselves. Finally, before we start, I wanted to make a special notice that next Sunday we will be celebrating Karen Spidell and her service with us. She's our outgoing bookkeeper. She's been here for 30 plus years, and we are so sad to see her go, but we're excited for her next journey as a grandmother. And so there is a card outside on the table as you leave. Please feel free to write her a note so that we can celebrate her next Sunday. With that, let's enter into a time of worship.
Salve Regina, Mater misericordiae, vita dulcedo, et spes nostra salve. A te clamamus, exules filii Eve, a te suspiramus, gementes et flentes, in ac lacrimarum vale. Ea ergo advocata nostra, illos tuos misericordes oculos, ad nos converte. Et Iesum, benedictum fructum ventris tui, nobis post hoc exilium ostende. O clemens, o pia,
join me as you choose with the opening prayer and Lord's Prayer printed in your bulletin. Holy One, be with us this morning as we try to put words to your magnitude and your mystery. The first people called you Eternal Spirit, Earth Maker, Pain Bearer, Life Giver. Today we call to you with the words Jesus taught. Our Mother, Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever.
Praise the source of faith and learning. sparked and stoked the mind with a passion for discerning how the world has been designed. Let the sense of wonder flowing from the wonders we survey keep our faith forever growing and renew our need to pray. God of wisdom, we acknowledge that our science and our art and the breadth of human knowledge only partial truth impart. Far beyond our calculation lies a depth we cannot sound, where your purpose for creation and the pulse of life are found. As two currents in a river fight each other's undertow, till converging they deliver one coherent steady flow. Lend, O God, our faith and learning till they carve a single course, till they join as one, returning praise and thanks to you, their souls.
Good morning. We move into a time of blessing. So anyway, you have been up as our director. So of her. So I'd like to invite members of the LCDC to come forward who are here. So Tina and Jeannie. Susan is not here this morning, and Stephen is not here as well, but those are the other members of your LCDC. I'd also like to call your mother Martha forward, and Abby, daughter. So come on, crowd up here.
So I'm so grateful to this congregation for having me as a field education student. It has been a wonderful 8 months, and I'm grateful for all of the opportunities you've given me to preach and participate in funerals and weddings and pastoral care and some of the decisions that the church has to make, especially during COVID. There's no shortage of decisions we have to make. And so I thought I would just give you a quick update on where I am in my discernment. If I have a couple more classes to take, and if I discern the call to try to be ordained, I would have to write a very intimidating paper. That's which, well, what I've learned from discerning God's call is if it really terrifies me, I should probably do it. But I think what I discern most of all, the call that I feel, is that I am so happy in this church and in this congregation. And I love what I do as the director of families, youth, and children. And I love the people I work with, and I love all of you. So, you know, to leave and pastor another church doesn't sound as fun to me right now, but why would I leave? So I don't know. I'm still in discernment, and will continue to discern. My my field education supervisor that I met with weekly once had me read a book by Parker Palmer, and his advice was write down what you can't not do. So that's really fun to think about. What can you not? What can you not do? And for me, the first thing that came to mind was I can't not be in discernment, which is to say I can't not listen for God's call to me through the movement of the Spirit in this world. And this church has shown me how to do that. So I'm so grateful. Thank you. And I'll be here. Not going anywhere.
Well, thank you, Hadley. And just personally, I'll say it's just been an incredible pleasure to work with you always, but in this particular aspect of discernment and trying some different parts of ministry than you would have otherwise probably tried. Ministry is about call, and so that's between you and God and your community, and I know that you're very involved with that, but the ministry is also about competence, about doing it well and with excellence, and you are amazing. The way that you connect with families and children and adults and people of all ages, intergenerational ministry, the way that you embrace ministry with nausea, right? Knowing that there's just enough light for the next step. And you're preaching and you're praying and your visitation. You just put that all together with grace and with faith and with an openness that just invites people to journey along with you. So thank you for sharing yourself with all of us to great effect. In the midst of a pandemic, what? Crazy. Incredible. And Mom and Abby and LCDC, thank you for helping her with her discernment, and I invite us all to continue that. And thank you to this congregation for providing the opportunity for her to grow and for us to grow along with her. Let's continue to do that as we move forward. We will have a blessing, and normally I would have us sort of gather around and lay hands, but just to be safe, is it okay if your mom and daughter lay hands on you? Maybe one on either side. And Tina and Jeannie, if you want to, there we go, okay. Let us be together in prayer. Loving God, you have sown love and loving kindness and mercy and peace and justice into the fabric of this world, and you have called us to be partners with you in that work. You call each of us in various ways. Some of us are hands, and some of us are feet, and some of us are mouths, and some of us are eyes, and some of us are ears. And all of us, I think, are more than one of those. So we thank you for calling us together in the congregation and for calling us to use what we have and what you've given us and given us the opportunity to increase and enhance. We give thanks for Hadley and for her heart and for her faith and for her mind and for her skill and for her willingness to do that crazy thing to answer your odd and wondrous calling in her life. Continue to do that today and forever in her life and in all of our lives. And help it to become clearer and clearer what she just cannot not do. And may that result always in love growing within her and out through her into the world that is in need of such desperate need of love. Be with us today as we celebrate her ministry, as she continues her work here as our minister of family, children, and youth, and help us all to have fun, to celebrate, and to grow with her as she grows with you. For we pray this in the name of Jesus the Christ, the one who calls and sends and loves. Amen. Yes, hugs are great. Now.
Okay, let's do it. So as we come to our time of prayer this morning, are there joys and concerns to share? Yes. Thank you. So prayers for Jack Curtis, who is suffering from cancer. Prayers for his treatment and healing and peace. Thank you. Yes, Jim.
I'd like us to pray this morning. We don't know yet how bad, but a lot of time there.
Thank you. Prayers for the people of Haiti who are suffering greatly and probably scared. Yes. Hooray! Prayers of joy for Kathy and Rad and 27 years. Thank you. Prayers for the family of Jeanette Baker and also for the family of Bim Worley. Prayers of gratitude for their lives. Thank you. Cam. Thank you. Prayers of joy for Dalton, 1 year old, and the cupcake he destroyed. Sounds familiar. And prayers of concern and healing and peace for the people of Afghanistan in this time. I would offer up a prayer for Connie Kendall, who is grieving her husband, Don Taub, whose funeral was here a couple Fridays ago. Prayers for peace. With that, let us pray. Holy God, we showed up this morning. And here we are offering up our hearts to you again with our love and our fear and our inevitable distraction. You know we get stuck on things, but they feel so important. Things in our relationships, in our homes, in the news, in our jobs and bank accounts. We want things the way we want them. Return us to love when we are filled with fear. Return us to faith when we are filled with doubt. Remind us how to forgive others and ourselves. Thank you for your constancy and for your continued faith in us. Give us the faith we need to let you lift our hearts. Help us to rest in your presence for a while so we can continue the work that Christ modeled, practicing peace, working for justice, and leading with love. Amen. So as we come to our time of offering, we recognize with gratitude all we have been given and the opportunity to share our gifts. Thank you for all of the ways that you share your gifts and your blessings with this church. And if you would like to give online, you can go to charlotteucc.org. And if you would like to give in person this morning, there are baskets at the entrances, at both entrances. So let us pray. Holy One, thank you for blessing us with your love. And thank you for the opportunity to be conduits of your love. Bless our offerings that they may reach where they are needed most. Amen.
We're experiencing technical difficulties. Please stand by.
There is a mountain. There is a sea. There is a wind within all breathing. There is an arm to break every chain. There is the fire in all things living. There is a voice that speaks from the flame. I am for you. I am for you. I am for you. I touch the lost and the dying, sending us forth, he says to his friends, I am for you, I am for you, I am for you to the end. We are anointed.
Thank you, Cameron, for blessing us with your music. Today's reading is from John chapter 20, verses 24 to 29. But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. And although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." And so ends today's reading.
Good morning. H. Scott Ripley is a 45-year-old married father of one who lives near Galveston, Texas, and serves on the State Republican Committee. He is a deep conservative, which is his right as an American, and a devout Christian, which is also his right. For much of the pandemic, he has been fiercely outspoken about what he sees as a mishandling of COVID, as well as possible hidden agendas in the public health policy in response. When he heard about a mask burning event in Cincinnati, he went online to praise it. When he learned about incentives and giveaways to encourage people to get vaccinated, he posted a reply, disgusting. When the health commissioner of Baltimore, the physician, praised the effectiveness of a vaccine, he went on Twitter to call her an absolute enemy of free people and included a hashtag I will not repeat. More recently, he equated Germany's mask mandates to Nazism. Now, I dislike all comparisons to Nazism because they trivialize the murder of 6 million people and the sacrifices of millions more to stop the slaughter. But I bet you can guess where this story is headed. After symptoms appeared and worsened and led to him being on a ventilator in intensive care, Mr. Apley died last week of COVID. He left behind an unvaccinated wife who also has the virus. He also left a one-year-old son. The family now has a GoFundMe campaign to pay for the funeral, as the first of a lifetime expenses the family breadwinner will no longer be contributing to. I am completely perplexed. The thinking of people like Mr. Apley is so far from my own, from my friends and family and work colleagues, I must admit I do not understand. How did they arrive at their beliefs? How do they know what to believe and why? There is a temptation to find a kind of gratification in these deaths, a sense of justice, accountability, or karma. Because these people put the lives of others at risk in addition to their own, there is a whiff of deserved retribution. I reject that view. No death should bring us pleasure. There are real children left behind. So the first creed I feel compelled to profess about Mr. Apley is God bless everyone, no exceptions. The second step is to inquire of my own faith, not just what I believe, but how I get there. Set aside vaccines and ask about God. How can I be so sure that anyone is wrong and that I'm right? We are a nation of Thomases, deniers of climate change, disobeyers of evacuation orders from last week's massive Dixie fire in California to next month's hurricanes boiling up the Atlantic coast. These rejections of common sense do not occur only on the political right, by the way. They have an identical twin. Before COVID, most vaccine exemption claims came from liberals. Likewise, the efforts to dismantle fluoridation and public water supplies. The proportion of scientists questioning the safety of genetically modified organisms in food is nearly the exact same as the percent of scientists who believe that climate change is not real. And raw milk is a staple for some families in Vermont now. New state law for its distribution, though the life-saving sanitation merits of pasteurization have been thoroughly documented since the chemist Louis Pasteur invented it in 1862, after he invented germ theory and invented vaccines for anthrax, cholera, and rabies. When denial of the evidence comes from all corners, it might be a sign that this is not a momentary political problem, but an aspect of human nature. We are skeptics. And forget even being like Thomas, who, at least when he saw the facts, was confronted with the wounds, came to believe. Here, the factual count of cases and deaths from COVID have changed amazingly few minds. And so we arrive at questions of faith. Universe created in 6 days plus one of rest? Jews led by Moses through the Red Sea? Jesus born of Immaculate Conception? Scripture is given to us whole, the great big book. Yet don't we all pick and choose what we accept and what we, if not ignore, at least diminish? I believe every word of the Beatitudes, for example, the Sermon on the Mount about who is blessed and why. Yet I have no problem setting aside the judgments and punishments of Leviticus. I have my own notion about the origin of all things and evolution, yet for me, somehow it does not contradict Genesis. When I treat Eden not as a literal fact, but as a metaphor for the earth, so that it makes sense within the world I experience and what science has told me, am I being the religious version of a climate denier? I don't know. Let me expand on that. Where do we come from? Don't know. Why are we here? Not sure. Where will we go at the end of our lives? Hard to say for certain. Turns out many of the most important questions can only be answered by faith. Perhaps this is why the novelist Madison Smart Bell once remarked, "Heaven is the place where you are taken into a room and everything is explained." Now I'm going to do something I never do and speak publicly about my faith. This story begins with a guy whose childhood as a devout Catholic, quite literally an altar boy, was obliterated by a church that tolerated, concealed, and condoned thousands of priests committing generations of predatory sexual abuse, yet continues to preach and condemn and in general open its mouth about proper sexual behavior from birth control to abortion to homosexuality, when in my view it has lost all moral standing. Eventually, and despite being the nephew of a Franciscan monk, I rejected the supposed virtues of priesthood as if turning away from sin. Since that time, I have not joined any faith community, not the Burlington UU, where I went for 5 years, not the Zen Center in Iowa City that I visited on and off for 2 years, not any Taoist group, though I read one lesson in the ancient spiritual text Tao Te Ching every day for 30 years, not even this place, where I have come to worship for 18 years now, among kind people, many of whom I consider friends. Not because I reject any of these paths, but because when it comes to faith, I am just not certain. You know, at the start of worship many weeks, Kevin and Susan say that greeting, no matter where you are in your spiritual journey, you are welcome here. I suspect most people glide right by it, but those words are aimed directly at me. Not knowing has become a part of my faith as present as any commandment. And then something happened. Last September, I had been fit enough to be just behind my son when he was first to finish the Kelly Brush Foundation bike ride. By October, I was much slower and wondered how I could be aging so rapidly. By December, any exercise had to be followed by a nap of as deep a sleep as I'd ever known. By January, I struggled to climb a flight of stairs. By February, I had to rest halfway up. I was not responding to any treatment, and the cause was not clear. As some of you know, in early March, doctors found that one of the arteries that supplies my heart was 80% blocked, and another one 70%. I received excellent medical care. I'm on a ridiculous array of medicines. I go to cardiac rehab 3 times a week. My diet is entirely changed. My heart's stented, and I'm out of danger. Reckoning so plainly and factually with my mortality and its effect on my sons and siblings is a whole nother sermon, but I want to focus on the faith part of it. When you go into a hospital alone, when you're wheeled into the cardiac procedure area alone, when you waken in your room afterward alone, all of it requires something of you, a kind of hardness. You have to meet the moment. My friend Dorothy, who's a physician assistant, came and sat with me in the recovery area till she had to get back to work on another floor. Then I did something, some reaching out, family, a very few friends. One of the first of them was Jessica Sidway, who I often sit with here in the back of the church, because I remember when she had scary health difficulties, mostly alone, and I knew she would understand. She was excellent, supportive, loving. She also told a few people. I heard from Kevin, who offered his support in the warm and human tones we've all come to appreciate from him. Hadley sent sweet and uplifting emails too. I received nice cards and especially a nice one from Ebeth. I learned that Stephen Rose in the prayer circle had added me to their list, that they were praying for me. That is an act of kindness, so unexpected. 5 months and 10 days later, I still can't quite believe it. And then Susan texted me two photographs in the hospital. The first one was a lit candle casting its small, fragile, silent glow into the darkness. It's the same as the image on today's program. And the second, because Susan goes on walks every day and I live about a mile from her, was a photo of my house draped in snow. "Your life," she texted me, "is waiting for you to come home." Now, I may be a mess about what I believe, but I know the grace of God when I see it. Her thoughtfulness melted that hardness into a puddle and left me lying there with all kinds of faith that the medical interventions might save me, that a recovery was possible, that I was cared for in ways I had not imagined, that I was not alone. And it's from this that I see a possible way through in a nation of Thomases. What do we do about the deniers, the wrongly self-righteous, the stubborn people willing to die for their ignorance? I'm afraid the answer is difficult. It requires creativity, like Susan showed in those photos. It requires generosity, like so many people showed to me. It demands of us to follow an example set for us long ago in Galilee. We have to find the grace of God and use it. Maybe we donate to the GoFundMe campaign for the late Mr. Apley's son. Maybe we contribute to the United Way that serves one of the scorched areas of California. Maybe we put aside our disdain and seek a path toward kindness. I don't like what Mr. Apley did and said, yet he was created in the image of God, just like me, flawed, just like me, mortal, just like all of us. Condemning him and people like him is the easy way. Sending them grace is harder, but might help him, and in the process, might save our souls. God bless everyone, no exceptions.
For our missions moment today, we have one final celebration. As Stephen mentioned, the members of this congregation, you are so generous. And so we have some school supplies to give to Lund this morning. We are going to bless them. And so thank you to Sandy and Susan, who shopped for just this sample, not just this sample, but tons more in the vestry. If you peek inside, you can see over $1,100 worth of school supplies. So they will go to 30 elementary school students and 10 high school students. And thank you. We are hoping this morning that you will join us in a blessing of these. So as we begin, I invite you to close your eyes and remember a first day of school that you had. What did you wear? What did you carry? What did you feel like? Loving God, bless these pencils, notebooks, erasers, scissors, folders, crayons. Bless these tools for learning and creativity, and bless the hands of the children who will hold them. May they have confidence, curiosity, and know that they are capable. Help them to know also that they are loved by you and by us. May they have all of the resources and resiliency they need to flourish. Amen. Other announcements. It looks like a lovely day for fellowship outside, so thank you for joining us as you are moved. Next Sunday, Kevin will be preaching. We will be here in the sanctuary, and we will celebrate Karen Spidell. The following Sunday will be the blessing of the animals, so outside on the lawn. That is August 29th, and the rain date for that is September 5th, which is Labor Day weekend, so we're really praying for good weather on the 29th. Let's see, there is a church cabinet meeting this Wednesday at 5:30 on Zoom, and there's also the last BYO picnic for Sunday school families at Shelburne Beach. 5:30 to 7:30. If you're not a Shelburne resident, don't worry about it. You can email me. We are covering parking, and you just bring a picnic, or as we have experienced, just feed your kids in advance because they will not sit to eat. They would just want to play. I think that is it for announcements. Any other announcements this morning? Okay. That. May God bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you, be gracious to you, and grant you peace. Amen.
May the blessings of God shine upon you. May God's peace abide in you. May God's presence illuminate your hearts now and forever.